sort of look at this curious English pragmatic scene, and now increasingly he seems to spend a lot of his time in the United States, developing way on from the well-known drawings with the crocodile and the Seine and the megastructure over the top. But all since I have ever heard him, one can still relate the more cerebral things that he does with the crocodile in the Seine and the spatial quarter. One still feels that, in a very unusual way, his work has been a continual augmentation and development up from that work which inspired us from the period 10 years ago at Folkestone. And I'm really pleased to see Yona here. I've been wanting him to come to the Net for ages, and this seemed to be the obvious excuse.
Thank you, Peter.
I'm sorry, I am giving my usual apology of speaking English not so well, so, and I will not speak about anything concerning my work at the moment, or not too much. I would like to use the occasion that I was an unhappy participant of the Vancouver conference. That means I was unhappy, I was obliged to be there, and I would like perhaps to start with some impressions there. You know about how it happened with the Vancouver conference. There was a governmental conference, a very official one, where 2,000 delegates were sitting down. Everybody had about, let us tell in average, 1.5 minutes to express his very valid opinions. And opinions are always very valid for 1.5 minutes. And besides this, there was a forum where theoretically, again, everybody could speak out freely about the same type of limitations. Now, the Vancouver conference proved for me a very important thing. It proved that there is today nobody in the world who has bad intentions. I don't think that I ever heard about so much good intentions than in this good 2 weeks, except neither in the forum, neither in the, nor in the conference. Nobody thought about if the good intentions are implementable. And I think that our problem today is not anymore to discuss about intentions, but to see what can be done, and what can be done with a deadline. If somebody is talking about an action program, and he says, I'm criticizing myself from 15 years ago, and he tells that sometimes it will be done, this might be perhaps a good thing in certain periods, not today. Today, we have to somehow to tell what can we do till the end of this year, till the end of next year. I'm sorry, I'm not looking for a very technocratic programming, but not to stay with vague goodwill. The Vancouver conference, both at the forum, both at the conference, asked that it should be a more just sharing of riches in the world, which is absolutely a beautiful moral thing. How should it be done? I didn't hear a word about it. Then it was the question that we have the, everybody has the right to have a shelter. So it was told nobody discusses it. Not even the most reactionary government will not come out that I don't want that people should have a shelter, but how to do it? How to do it immediately? And the most spectacular thing in Vancouver was what they were calling Water Day. but meant that about 2,000 people with some top politicians were taking a bucket of water for 1.5 miles to show that it's very difficult in many several countries to get water. And then they made a declaration that they proposed for all governments that they should do, that people should have water everywhere. Very fine. How? They didn't propose what to do. And I would add to this an other remark. I was not so long time ago in one of the third-world countries where the government made probably the most beautiful water network I saw for the shanty towns. It has only one difficulty, that you have there water, if you have a tap, every 2 days for 2 hours. So water is practically continued to be distributed by lorries. So why not? I have nothing against the system of lorries, but I don't think that that's the way to act. And I think perhaps we are getting away from a certain attitude what we had all, perhaps 10, 15 or 20 or so many years ago, which was to find the technical utopias. The technical proposals. The technical proposals exist. But what can really be done? If I would propose now this infrastructure I was proposing in the 60s. So I would realize that in the meantime, I would by no ways find people who could do it. I wouldn't find the equipment to fabricate it. As the situation is today, I wouldn't find the people who would do it at the site. I wouldn't find the transport means to do it. I am not speaking against industrialization. I am speaking about a situation today, good or bad, it's a fact. And so there was as well at Vancouver, out of this reason, quite a lot of talk about self-help. Now, to talk about self-help, that's wonderful. I believe in self-help. But if we are talking about self-help, so this is again the experts' very paternalistic approval. You are doing, helping yourself, you are doing it very nicely, and everything is good. That's what is not really a contribution. So, if we are speaking for self-help, what can we do? What can be a useful role of us? So I think this question is completely open. I was proposing at the Vancouver conference a very polite and nasty proposal. I was proposing that the conference should do only a one phrase statement, that we all, forum and conference, we are incompetent to solve these problems, which would at least make a clear situation. You know, there are about 3 billion people today who have some problems concerning habitat. Habitat, I am calling, to be precise, food and roof. It's a precise order. It's not roof and food. And people who are working for roof, they annihilate the possibility to produce food. People who try to promote food, they are absolutely neglecting the problem of roof. So we are in an absolutely ridiculous situation also. Now, there is one thing which is worse. There was always, everybody was talking about the poor in Vancouver. Everybody, but there was nobody who no poor, I didn't see anybody who was poor. Because somebody can come from a poor country and he can be a minister. He is not poor. He doesn't know really the problems. Or to the forum, somebody can come as and living in a self-made house in Canada, but he is not poor. And I dare to tell this because in the last year, I visited quite a number of countries and I saw the situation. And I am sometimes even asking myself if the idea of poorness, what we are talking about, if this is not an occidental export. I saw people in, if you want, in South America and Africa, who don't consider themselves poor. They are not in the money economy. They are not using currency. They produce food, they have their shelter, they produce their shelter, they produce their clothing, they produce their survival. And I think that the problem I want to launch this afternoon, this would be perhaps a question which is not new, but somehow escaped us. What would mean an architecture of survival? Perhaps an architecture of survival or a planning of survival would mean that we cannot count anymore of long distance relief. Actually, your food, the food in people in Africa in certain parts, the food in people in South America is completely based on the idea that it will be brought in from somewhere, X thousand miles away. The problem of shelter is based on the idea that it will be brought in from somewhere, again, X thousand miles away. Now, this question is very, very questionable. Let us imagine even nothing very brutal, only transports break down. So what happens? This touches as well the shanty towns. The shanty towns, for example, everywhere in the world, except in certain parts of Africa, they don't produce food. One of the most surprising things, if you are looking at in South American shanty towns, that they might be about 60% of a town's population, they are completely dependent on the town. So, on services brought from far away. And if I was telling you about this problem with the water day, this would mean that perhaps the action, what we could do, this is not to propagate an occidental type of system which could be realized in 20 years from now, but how can you use, for example, your roof as rain collector, as a rainwater collector, very simply, and how can you use a simple water storage what you can do till next March? That's realizable. So that's the problem today. And I think I don't want to come up with solutions because I don't think that me or anybody else is capable to come up with solutions. Everybody, if you are meeting so-called responsible people in different governments, so they will immediately tell, okay, we have magnificent plans, but we have nobody or no organization or nothing which implements it. So it's these plans are practically non-existent. So this is really this problematic. So the first suggestion I would look for, oh, here I have some water, about this problematic would be perhaps we should revise the exportation of images we are doing. Actually, we export an Occidental image with a promise, what we cannot keep. If you are presented with such a such Occidental proposal, why not? The actual American proposal. You cannot do actually with the imaginable technical setup for 4 billion persons. It's unimaginable today. I am not speaking now, perhaps in 50 years it's possible. But in the 50 years, we have to live up till this date. So, we can look for something what I'm calling a simple technology. Simple technology means a technology people know before. That means which doesn't need to be taught because people know to handle it. Because if we have to start and everybody would learn even the best technology, the time span this might take, it's too long. Now, the simple technology, really it is very simple, but it can be used in many different ways. We can perhaps find some ways how perhaps scientific results today can be translated in simple technology. Actually, very strangely, I found myself very much involved with a project that has a curiosity because it was backed not simply by the Americans, but by the Chinese and by the Russians, which is a very unusual situation, and which has the very beautifully sounding title, Inducing Popular Creativity in Sciences. But what does it mean? Scientific laboratories have results, for example, in agriculture, in food production, for example, in water collecting, for example, in food conservation, because if I'm speaking about food, that's not only food production, but how to keep up food. And some of these scientific results can be applied, implemented with very, very simple knowledge which exists in certain places. And as the simple technology means simple technologists, the simple technologists can suggest back to the scientific laboratory how to improve their results. You know probably that you heard about surely a lot about the Green Revolution. The Green Revolution was implemented in India with very good results for some time. Only something was forgotten, that the Green Revolution means a guaranteed water reserve. That means, if you use the improved cereals, and for 2 years you didn't have rain, you produce a desert. You lose the grain and you produce a desert. So Indian farmers, very logically, were going back to traditional wheat where they are sure of a guaranteed output, even if the rate is less. So this is perhaps an example. If the scientific laboratory would be informed that the farmer cannot work with the Green Revolution, that means with the improved cereals, in the laboratory conditions, but he has to work in the farmer's conditions, then the Green Revolution would be an advance over the traditional crop, but it wouldn't try to go too far and risking too much. I can give you another example. I was a year ago in Egypt. Now, Egypt, probably you know, it is the most densely inhabited country today in the world. It's 1,200 persons the square kilometer, which is quite enormous. I'm not counting the desert. I'm counting only the Nile Valley. And it is really found, I would tell, nearly in spots like this, or like this, no, this room, this would be enormous there. And a country with this density has the survival possibility. That means if Egypt wouldn't be completely, wouldn't have the cotton farming that they could reconvert, what they try, reconvert to food production, they could be self-sufficient. 1,200 persons ever. And there in Egypt I saw certain projects of what's called reconquest of the desert. Reconquest of the desert, so generally the governmental practice was to try to do a reconquest at relatively big size, a big bank of land, and generally this doesn't work. Contrarily to this, the Egyptian peasant reconquests the desert in another way. He moves 5 meters a year, or in 2 years. After 2 years or 3 years, this 5 meters span begins to be usable, not to a very good result, but it becomes dis-deserted. I'm sorry for the barbaric expression. And you can do this way of action. So, all this means that survival in the actual situation can be difficultly resolved by large-scale action. A large-scale action is unimplementable, and a large-scale action takes too big risk, a big risk of failure, once, even if it is temporarily successful. Searching a large-scale project implies again the money economy. It's a different accountancy system. And then with large-scale actions, a country becomes necessarily poor because it has to get money, it indebts itself. In a small-scale action, a country can survive because the investment is not money. It's really a small human action. If you would use as currency really energy, like the physicist says, the both systems are the same. But the accountancy is different because the small-scale human energy is not doesn't get to the same column of the accountancy, and the large-scale project gets to another column. So I think we are in face of a development which is not new, but which can be recognized today as again emerging after it was lost for a long time. This is what I would call the survival guerrilla. We are speaking very much about all kinds of other guerrillas. Perhaps the most important guerrilla would be and the most human one would be the survival guerrilla. That means the small groups who organize their survival for the case if the large system breaks down. take care. I am not telling that you should break down the large system. This would be an idiotic thing. But I am, what I am trying to tell, that we need an alternative network of small survival system. I'm sorry, Peter, I'm not speaking about architecture, but I'm speaking about a habitat conference. And architecture is only a part of it. So I think this is really the unsolved part. Now, if all this hypothesis, what I was talking to you, is true, so what can we do, you and me here? What can we do in this situation? Obviously, we were telling that the large-scale planning is not sufficient. We have all the, you are all formed for large-scale planning. For the small-scale intervention, you are not formed, and you are not necessary because these people do it better than you would do. That means they don't want appraisal from you. That's they are don't read journals and they don't care about. So, what could we do? So, I am trying now to do a certain action in different levels, which is a tentative. I don't know if it will be successful, but we will try. You can take over, perhaps, the primary school teachers or the sub-primary school teachers' role. That means a communication. You can inform people that such and such techniques exist. What they will do with them, we cannot foresee. For example, if in such and such big town of South America, which is, you don't know where begins the shanty town and where begins the real town, and when they have no water supply, I think now about a very concrete example. In this town, you have every 5 days a tropical rain. The tropical rain washes away the shanty town's houses, but they have no water supply. So something is contradictory, surely, because these people were immigrants. They came from somewhere else. They don't, even if I don't want to tell that somewhere else, from some other country, but from a completely other region of this country, from a place where they don't have tropical rains, etc. So now, if you can show them that there are, for example, different rain collecting techniques actually existing, such techniques in the Middle East and such techniques in Asia and such techniques in South America, in other parts, then they will do somehow. They are inventors themselves. So you suggest perhaps several lines of invention. Perhaps the invention they will do, it will be another line, what you didn't suggest, that it's completely possible. But you have to get them this information, because without this, they will sit there and they will wait till the government will install the water network, but they will never do, or never do in a sufficient way. Another thing, for example, the rainwater in certain periods washes away houses. But is it for you, perhaps as technicians, it sounds completely surprising, but one has to see the fact really to believe. Now, simply, there are different techniques, very simple techniques, really in the simple technology way, how you can make these houses either resistant or to do that way that the rainwater goes underneath it. You have it in many places on stilts. So that's something that you can do. You can do as well perhaps a certain action, what I wouldn't call political, but you can suggest certain actions for the government. For example, I was telling, when I was asking, what you need to do for the shantytown. That's surely not the asphalted roads, because nobody will use it. Surely not the water network, because it will not work, and by any means, whenever it will work, you will chase away these people and you will do there something else, what is might be rentable. But give them simply, for example, corrugated sheets for the roof. A roof which is waterproof, that's something what today you can help. We could imagine, for example, to give for 4 billion persons at least watertight roof material. They will construct it themselves. They will do the thing. But at least you can do this. If you want to do something more, you might give them stairs, which is the expensive material. So what will be now tried in this particular town, it will be a sort of a, I would call a credit card, I'm sorry, it's the bad expression, but a credit card issued by the local government, which can be honored only with material. Now, obviously, this chap who takes it in the shanty town might be that he will traffic with this material. We have absolutely no way to know. By any means, the risk is relatively small that he will not use it for himself. Some of them might traffic it, but most of them, they will use it. I saw it from some examples where this type of system worked. So I think that we could come in, perhaps something for what we, perhaps we were trained, that's simply to use imagination. Because people, the 4 billion people, were discouraged from imagination, they were discouraged centuries. And we have not to tell them what you should do, but we have to perhaps to throw in alternatives. Now, I wanted I will leave with Peter a document, which is only an exemplary document of this thing. I'm sorry, it takes a moment, I need to. Okay. What we try, actually, is to do certain very simple manuals. You know, in this way, about the house, your house begins with a roof. The roof protects you from the rain, from the sunshine. You are living part under the roof, part outside, and so on. So this type of manuals obviously cannot be done in a poor country as a booklet. You cannot imagine, for example, in an Egyptian village where there are 10,000 inhabitants to distribute 2,000 booklets, or in Peru or wherever you want. It's impossible because it would be too costly. So this type of manuals, they are simply pasted up. It's a sort of a wall journal. That means for the township of 10,000 inhabitants, 4 manuals are sufficient. There are carefully no instructions in it. There are suggestions, and do with it what you want, comment it as you want. Now, obviously, you will tell that what to do if people don't read. Okay, actually, in all these villages, there is a very small percentage, but there are people who read. And it's enough, they discuss. Now, obviously, this type of manual I'm talking to you, it is a, what I'm calling a prototype manual. And then, in such and such region, people redo it in another one, other way. For example, I was seeing how they were redoing in Papua New Guinea, and it was quite astonishing for me, and it was a very intelligent way. They were redrawing, reformulating, using the thing and transforming it. So that's what perhaps we can do. So I think that the action, what I'm trying to propagate at the moment, that certain topics, which are real, the real habitat topics, that means food, water, shelter, health, we try to do this type of manuals, and with United Nations help, we mail it everywhere. United Nations help is very important because there are many different countries in the world. All of them are somehow or other way dictatorships. And you cannot get in material, information material in these countries very easily, except if it bears a United Nations stamp. So it is, as it is the United Nations which gives, if you want, the franchise for the action. But the action is not a United Nations action because it is absolutely unimaginable to put up a big organization and a big staff which would kill absolutely everything. So it's a very small organization and action. And the document I wanted to leave you, that's not such a manual, but it is an example. This was done for the Vancouver conference. It was officially, again, it got a governmental stamp with it, with very small censorship here and there, but the governmental stamp was necessary because it was the only way to get it through. And this was really to explain for the Vancouver people. That means it's not the same language. It is the planner's language here. Contrarily, here to this one, which is the men of the streets language. But it was trying to show that even this planner's language can be translated at the men in the street level. It's bilingual because it was published in France, and obviously it is English as well, as we couldn't do. Contrarily to this one, which is now only in temporary English because the definitive is in Spanish, because it's for South America. So I think I was talking about this because with all the in a way pessimistic hypothesis, I would like to give this as one example of something that can be done. I am not guaranteeing that this is the good thing, and I am not guaranteeing that it's successful. But it can work relatively fast. That means, instead of promising, like everywhere in the world, that in 50 years you will live at such level, it tells that we can give you the information within 12 months, and you should try to improve your situation. And I think this is today really the breaking point with official architecture, with official conferences, with official organizations. We are living in a world where people are abandoned by the official organizations. But they are kept in the mythical situation that they have to believe in this official organizations, which is not anymore possible. So I think it was not a too long talk. That's what I wanted really to tell you. And I think I wanted to tell you that, for example, all people who had inventions in the years before, people like Conrad, people like others, they were practically bringing perhaps new elements for this action. This was, in a way, producing the stock, the repertoire. But now the next step is how to communicate this. So I think I was talking all this short talk about the communication problem. And I want, so to conclude, the practical, what we need to talk, that's not self-help, we all agree to this, but we have to talk about how can be things communicated on the 4 billion level. And that's an open problem. So thank you very much. I don't know the situation in London. It's very difficult, but I think if I will tell something about Paris, this might be perhaps... what I am trying to propagate in Paris, in certain things, I got till this point that it can be some very smooth-looking laws which pass the parliament, which can open up such a thing. So they are perhaps very small things. First, a similar information campaign we are trying to do. And the project is that way, that before any planning intervention, a primary school level explanation of planning and of the fallout of the planning should be pasted out in certain parts of the town. That means people actually in the West, there, if the government is very, very so-called full with goodwill and for users' participation, they show images. And they tell, let us discuss these images. What we tried is something completely different, to explain, really to give for the men in the street a knowledge, at primary school level, but a knowledge of the planner. He becomes a para-planner, and he can discuss not only the image, but really at the fallout. That's one of the operations which seem to work. There is a tremendous resistance against it. It's not easy to get through, and there is a tremendous sympathy. But so the thing is now at the level that a tentative law project, how are you calling, when you are proposing a law to the parliament, is prepared. A second thing a similar proposal that can be done in the West is any unused, temporarily unused surface should be, for the time it's unused by a private owner, it should be at the disposal of the public. Another project of law. That means there is a ground where at the moment you have no building. The law is proposing that way. That if you don't make a fence, you get a tax reduction, which is interests the owner. I'm sorry, we cannot change the political system. But, and this ground is at the disposal of the public all the time that there is no building on it. The next thing is the proposal of the parallel water system. But probably after this year will go far more easier than it was before, because in France it's the first really serious drought year. And people begin to realize that the central system is very good, but it would be important to have a parallel system for the case it breaks down. And very far away, it's you cannot do it perhaps too aggressively, but it's prepared that surfaces which could be used for food production in the town should be prepared for food production. I would tell that way. If you are looking at the roof surface of a town, simply the roofs, nothing more. The courtyard, a town like Paris couldn't survive for what food would be produced there, but it could work as a reserve. Because the food problem, actually, it is the storage, the food storage space. It has a very limited duration, as you probably know, in all the big towns. The food arrival is completely depending on transportation. That means if transportation breaks down, like if water pipelines break down, Paris is a town which could become empty in 6 months. It's the maximum reserve. So it begins to be understood that a town has to foresee somehow its own survival independently from transport, from storage organizations, and so on. So these are the point-wise actions we can do. But the point-wise actions are important not because they in themselves are so important, but because of their exemplary quality. People, if they realize that they can do something, so they begin to think about the next step. So that's what I don't know how far the situation is similar to London. So therefore, I prefer to give the Paris example. Dependent on voting. Should be there or not?
Structure which you were very keen on. Your ideas on the notice structure.
He doesn't like that word.
Is there any validity still in your thoughts of infrastructure? It talks about an ultimate success.
Yes, I think so in a certain way. I think two details, you know, I don't want to justify myself, and I will tell you that basically many points I'm realizing what I was doing. Because I don't think it would be ridiculous if I couldn't be critical of myself. But certain things seem to be spot-wise useful. First thing, what I was telling you about the rigidity of buildings in the Schwendigau, in the South America. So it's really by triangulating in a certain way the steels gives exactly this rigidity, but permits to resist the water flow. That's a one concrete example. The second thing, it seems that the practically the best action we can do, this means that there is a stilt system. And on this stilt system, the roof slabs space as a roof slabs location, situation is not defined. It's completely defined by the user. That means on this grid, obviously, you can translate it that way as if it would be, I am exaggerating very much, as if it would be a common roof, and where the users want, they take away a part and they create a courtyard. In reality, it acts exactly the other way. That means they make it out. The advantage seems to be that contrary to many 20-town techniques, this permits to them make the houses either contiguous or separate. Contrary to the classical techniques which doesn't admit the contiguous solution, which is in the same time, in many places, more coherent with the social system. That means not the family growth, but a sort of a clan. By any means, these are not decisions or solutions, but I can choose. Even in the first contacts, I realized that there are people who are interested in that and in the other. The second thing, this might be now an other usable point, but I was trying to propose in the 1960s what could be used this time of terms